I have been talking about on the Daily Briefing for a long time about the chart of Ethereum following exactly the chart of Bitcoin 2017. So much so that I've got it set up on my Bloomberg and it's tick for tick. And I tweeted it out this week about the sell-off. It's like, yeah, this is expected and it should turn around today. And it did. It's kind of spooky. But there's a number of things that I look at suggest, and again, we've talked about this endlessly, that this November-December period is very positive. But the chart I think is the most important chart right now is the chart of Ethereum versus Bitcoin. It's currently at 0.074. At 0.08, it breaks out of this lovely pennant pattern and a larger basing pattern that goes for years. It looks like its performance will double versus Bitcoin. Ethereum, as of today, is up 480% this year, and Bitcoin's up 100%. It tells you something crazy is about to happen in crypto markets. Does that mean that other tokens outperform Ethereum? Probably. It feels like we're getting close to the final crazy phase that often happens. How long that goes on for, I've got a different view on that. I think I've talked about it before. There's a lot of institutional allocation that's going to come in January, February, March. New hedge fund P&Ls all coming in. I think this cycle extends much further than people imagine and goes much higher in price. But we're right in the sweet spot for what traditionally would be a very strong market, and Ethereum should be the leader.
Well, explain what that chart does and exactly how you built it and why.
The chart overlays Ethereum now with Bitcoin back in 2017. I started looking at it when I got attacked for talking about Bitcoin, Ethereum, about a year and a bit ago on Twitter. And people were like, you know, you're cheating on us with Ethereum. It's a scam coin. I'm like, well, I'm going to look into this. And I started looking at Metcalfe's law and network adoption models and all of this. And I realized that Ethereum looked like Bitcoin did at exactly the same number of wallet addresses. I'm like, huh. And it was trading at the same price. I'm like, huh. And then I put one price over the other, and they were the same. So that chart is a previous rally. Basically, Ethereum came out 5 years later than Bitcoin and seems to lag it by a cycle. And bizarrely, Solana and Terra are lagging Ethereum by a cycle. So Ethereum had a huge end of year back in 2017. It would suggest that those two would too. It's a weird function. I think it's to do with network effects. Why it does it tick for tick is just pure voodoo. And at some point, the correlation will break apart. And that's fine. It's just hellishly amusing to watch because it's like, it's thumbing your nose at all of us who've tried to use these kind of these comparison charts before. And then they fail immediately when you look at them. And this one just refuses to fail, which is hilarious. My last GMI was called Steady As She Goes. And I think it continues is like, we're seeing this relative slowdown. The market should be relatively fine unless something dramatic changes. We are at the exciting point in the crypto cycle, so that will remain the focus. You know, I just recently did a trade in Macro Insiders in the euro. Nailed it. Absolutely nailed it. Made 4%. I mean, bloody Ethereum's up 6% today. This is the problem I've got. Is like, there is, you know, the risk reward is not great in traditional markets in comparison. So, I mean, the other one I've been focused on has been the carbon credits, which has been the carbon trade, which has been a phenomenal trade, which is up about over 100% this year. It's been the strongest performing commodity, carbon. So that's been interesting. But look, yeah, I think it's steady as she goes. Keep your eye on crypto. I know that's been pretty much the message for a while now, but it's worked.
How would you expect the crypto space to react to an equity drawdown or risk-off event? Is crypto a diversifier, or is it an added risk to a traditional portfolio? It's a great question.
It depends what kind of sell-off. If it is something's happened, China's invaded Taiwan, it's all going down. If it is the equity market rolls over and falls by 20% slowly over a matter of a few months, crypto's not going down. So it's really, it's to do with, are positions being liquidated, or is this just a general lull in markets? So it's only the short, sharp shocks that hit crypto, I think.
What do you think is the next narrative? Right now, there are more things like metaverse tokens, or is it DAOs and community tokens? It's a lot of questions.
So I think community and social tokens are later. I think they're they're really a year and next year and the year after, they'll start picking up steam. I think the metaverse is front and center right now. I think DAOs are going to get interesting. We're going to see the DAO structures around asset management that's going to get interesting as well. So there's a lot still to come. There's probably another wave of innovation coming out of DeFi. Mm. NFTs have obviously been the hot ticket, and that's not going to die down for the time being. Then it's the other layer one protocols, you know, the Solana, Avalanche, Terra, that kind of stuff. So there's actually too much to look at right now. But I think further out the risk curve, social tokens is later. Tokenization of real estate is even later than that. Coming closer is probably, yeah, asset management is coming. The rest of this year is about the layer ones. Yeah, I think mainly the layer ones and NFTs. I can't remember who explained this to me, but basically we're running tens of thousands of, probably tens of thousands of economic experiments.
Right.
In real time. We've never done this before. We've never been able to test business models. That one fails. We've learned from that one. We'll move on to that one. The rate of innovation and adaptation in this space is mind-blowing, because everybody's focusing on their bit.
Yes.
And there's a group of people focusing on that. They're all watching what each other's doing, watching the successes, the failures. And then a new group come in because they've learned here's another way of doing it. We've never seen business models being tested at such rapidity, because they can raise capital with such rapidity and such ease. It's truly something to behold. And also, I still linger on Yatsuri's thoughts about not only culture as an investment, but universal basic equity. That by being part of these communities, you have a token. And if that community thrives because you enjoy its culture and you want to help it, your token goes up. So you're creating assets out of not traditional, I'm looking at the balance sheet of General Electric.
Right.
You're doing something wildly different here, which is creating a community and a culture and helping it grow, and you make money out of it. It's like the guys who tried to buy the Constitution yesterday. I love the fact it was Stevie Cohen who outbid them. He probably did that on purpose, right? Just to poke one in the eye at all of these people. That wasn't Stevie Cohen, sorry, it was Ken Griffin, Citadel. So somebody's now starting a Citadel DAO to buy Citadel.
Good luck.
I was speaking to Kevin Kelly today as well, and there's another DAO being formed to buy a MBA team. Mm. And that's the idea, is that enough people pull together and they use a DAO structure to buy an MBA team, which is incredible.